Now, it is a huge, huge pleasure, really, to welcome to our midst Professor Rebecca Goldstein, who was educated at Barnard College, which is the college affiliated with Columbia University Women's College, still is, which is great. Rebecca did her PhD at Princeton, and then I think you taught at Barnard for quite a long time, didn't you? And the among the many significant things to say about Rebecca are these wonderful books she's written, and I've got a list of them here, I want to tell you about them. Quite early on in your career, you started out as a novelist as well as a philosopher, and you published a novel called The Mind-Body Problem, and the latest novel is 36 Arguments for the Existence of God, a work of fiction, which refers both to the novel itself and to God, of course. But a couple of books that I really do recommend to you, Incompleteness, which is a book about Gödel, the proof, Gödel's proof, and paradox of Kurt Gödel, and a book called Betraying Spinoza, The Renegade Jew Gave Us Modernity. Spinoza, of course, has come into focus hugely in recent years as the great architect of the Enlightenment and a very, very important thinker. So we're very fortunate indeed to have Rebecca with us. And I'm assured, those of you who are certainly anxious about the title of this talk, since it's got something to do with Gödel's Incompleteness Theorem, that you're going to survive it. Okay? Rebecca, over to you.
Thank you. Hi. So I'm going to be giving four lectures this week, and what I decided to do was to talk about the four things that I love the most, feel the most passionate about. And one of these is Gödel's Incompleteness Theorems. So we're going to start with that, and then I think tomorrow I'm going to be talking about some very new ideas I have. I've just finished a new book, almost quite finished a new book about Plato and Socrates and their relationship and why the Greeks invented philosophy. Want to talk to you a bit about those ideas tomorrow, and then in the afternoon tomorrow talk about Spinoza. And then the last lecture, I've decided to talk about being both a philosopher and a novelist. And Professor Grayling was right that I did in fact publish my first novel when I was very young, had just become a professor of philosophy, which was something only a very young and stupid person would do, to publish a novel when you're a young academic. But I want to talk to you about these two different worlds of literature and philosophy, and how what I've learned actually about philosophy by becoming a novelist. I've learned more about philosophy by becoming a novelist than perhaps than being a philosopher. So anyway, today we're going to talk about this incredibly beautiful result, Gödel's Incompleteness Theorem. Any of you have heard mathematicians waxing eloquent about the beauty of mathematics and wondered what in heaven's name were they talking about? What can be beautiful about mathematics? I hope that after today's lecture you'll have a sense of a little bit of what this is, what mathematical beauty is. Gödel's Incompleteness Theorems, the proof of Gödel's Incompleteness Theorem, have been described by somebody, one of my old professors, Ernest Nagel, as philosophical or mathematical symphony. It's like music, actually, to get into the proof, which I'm not going to be able to do today, but I want to give you a little bit of a sense of the architecture of the proof, the overall argument, and that I think you're going to get. But most importantly, something about why Gödel's Incompleteness Theorems are philosophically significant. That they're very, very special, because this is mathematics that also does something important in the foundations of mathematics. something in the philosophy of mathematics. Anyway, yes, I have this book on Kurt Gödel. There we go. So, that's Gödel as a young man. He had a legendary relationship with Albert Einstein. They were both refugees from Europe during the bad years, 1939 through 1945. And they met up together at Princeton's Institute for Advanced Study. And Gödel was quite a young man then. Einstein was toward the end of his life. And when I was writing my book, I was able to interview people who had been around during that time. I caught them just in time. Actually, they all died by the time the book came out. They had all died. They were very old, the people who had known them back in the 40s. But one after the other told me they would only talk to each other. They wouldn't talk to anybody else at the Institute for Advanced Study, which is a very, it's often called Mount Olympus, in sort of the Mount Olympus of academia in the States. It's very, very prominent people. Einstein was one of the first to be appointed there. It was often called Einstein's Institute while he was still alive. And let's see, do I have, yes, and Einstein toward the end of his life, I'm here too, I was able to speak to people who had known him. He was quite depressed. He was after his unified field theory. He was very disappointed that he wasn't able to get to this final theory that he was longing for. And he said that he only would go to his office every day at the Institute to have the privilege of being able to walk home with Gödel. He's in German, and here's a picture that somebody snapped of the two of them on this path to Field Hall from the Institute. So one of the things that I puzzled about in the book was, what was the source of the deep relationship between them? Why did they only want to speak to each other? And they had both produced something that had completely reconfigured the landscape of their respective fields. Einstein in physics and Gödel in foundations of mathematics. Mathematics as well, but even more importantly, foundations of mathematics. And they both felt as if their results had been misinterpreted. That it had been seized by the logical positivists. Is this a term that you are familiar with? Well, perhaps we'll talk about that a little later on. But they both interpreted their results as supremely realist results, that they were descriptive of reality. Einstein, physical reality, and Gödel, mathematical reality. And they felt as if their results had not been interpreted as they themselves had meant it. They were both supreme realists. We'll talk about that more, what that means in mathematics. I keep using this word foundations of mathematics. What does this mean? We'll talk about that a bit more. Gödel's incompleteness theorems are unusual because they sort of sit in the border between, sort of right on the border between mathematics and philosophy. They're mathematical results. They're truly proved. They're proved mathematically, but they seem to have some sort of implications regarding what mathematics is all about. So when I say foundations of mathematics, I mean these sorts of questions. What is it that mathematicians are doing when they're doing mathematics? Yes, so that they are mathematical theorems. They've been mathematically proved. they have a great deal to say about mathematics itself. They've been called, I think by me, the most loquacious mathematical results, perhaps in the history of mathematics. But it's not exactly clear what they're saying. They're saying something, but it's not exactly clear what they're saying, and people still argue about this. And it's interesting, if you know a little bit about Gödel himself, that he should have produced such loquacious theorems, because he himself was an unusually reticent man. And in fact, you know, I think that this had something to do with, he did not really like to discuss things with anybody except those who agreed with him. I think, in fact, after Einstein died, he became a famous recluse in Princeton. I ought to mention that I when I arrived as a graduate student in Princeton, Gödel was still alive. And the first thing I did when I got to Princeton was take out the phone book. In those days, we still had phone books, right? And we still use phones. And I looked up Gödel. I thought, maybe he's in the Princeton telephone book directory. And he was. There it was, Gödel, K. Gödel, and with his address and everything. But he was a famous recluse. He spoke to nobody, except there were 3 months in which he was somewhat more gregarious, and he actually came to a party at the Institute for Advanced Study welcoming newcomers, and I got to meet him. But I was too afraid to ask him the questions that I've since spent my life wishing I had asked him. So that's perhaps my most important message to you, to never be afraid to ask questions. It's the questions you didn't ask when you had the opportunities that will haunt you for the rest of your life. You'll have wished you had asked those questions. So anyway, he was a very reticent man, and I think part of his going after a proof of this sort is he had very strong intuitions that he formed when he was about your age, an undergraduate at the University of Vienna. Very strong intuitions about mathematics, what it was all about, philosophical views about mathematics. And he wanted a proof that could show this. He didn't like discussing philosophy with people. He wanted a proof that could accomplish this. And strangely enough, he found it. He didn't look like this at the time that he made his discoveries. He was about, we don't know exactly how old he was when he discovered the incompleteness theorems, but he looked like that, something more like that. He was about 22 or 23 years old. We don't know exactly when he did it because, again, as I said, he was very reticent, and he had this amazing proof, and he didn't let anybody know about it until he was at a conference, and then he just very casually dropped something that it might possibly be possible to have a proof that would show that there are certain true propositions that are unprovable. And nobody, this little casual statement went above everybody's, past everybody's head, except for one person who happened to be there, Johann von Neumann, and he caught this. And he said, wait a minute. He said to him afterwards, did you just say that you actually have a proof for this? And if it had not been for von Neumann, who knows, maybe the whole thing would have been lost, maybe, because he was an odd man. Okay, so it seems very odd that there could be a mathematical result that would have philosophical implications, that would have implications about what mathematics is all about. It seems odd because math and philosophy seem very different to each other, don't they? I mean, they seem like very different fields.
mathematics is about numbers, whereas philosophy is about language, truth, existence, knowledge, causality, identity, goodness, love. Philosophy has more of the human element in it than mathematics seems to have. And mathematical questions are so precise, right? There's one answer to a mathematical question, whereas philosophical questions often seem so very vague, with many possible answers to them. So it seems that the two seem to have a very different sort of flavor, mathematics and philosophy. Most importantly, mathematics proves its conclusions with finality. Once you have a mathematical proof for something, it's a proof, right? That's what one means by a proof. It's been proved, and nothing is going to cause us to take it back. Whereas, there's almost nothing that any philosopher has said that some other philosopher hasn't argued was false, right? There's not very much finality in philosophy. So it would be a very big deal if somebody were able to put forth a mathematical proof with all of its finality that would be also a philosophical conclusion. That would be a very big deal. We don't get that very often in philosophy. And that's what Gödel's incompleteness theorems appear to be doing, which would really make them unique in the history of philosophy. What kind of philosophical truth are we talking about here? What kind of philosophical implications would Gödel's incompleteness theorems have? It's basically epistemological that we're talking about here, which means, of course, having to do with the nature of knowledge. The word epistemology comes from the ancient Greek, as everything in philosophy comes from the ancient Greek, comes from the word for knowledge, episteme. An epistemologist, what does an epistemologist think about? Epistemologist thinks about knowledge, right? What is knowledge, first of all? How does it vary from mere belief, even true belief? The conventional answer, although there are certain counterexamples, very specialized counterexamples to this, but the, known as the Gettier paradox, counterexamples, but in general, we mean by knowledge, it's not simply true belief, but that it's justified true belief. There's some good reasons one has for believing it. It's grounded. So if every morning you have the nightmare the next day is going to be Monday morning, the weekend is over, you have to get back to class, and every morning you wake up, your heart pounding, thinking, oh God, it's Monday. And this morning you woke up thinking, and I woke up thinking, oh God, it's Monday. It's a true belief, right? But I didn't know it. If I'm believing it on the basis of this nightmare that I have every night, that the next morning is Monday, although it's a true belief, it's not a justified true belief, because 6 days out of seven it's going to lead me to a false belief. So that's not very good odds, is it? Not very good grounding. And so that would not be justified true belief. Of course, this moves the whole onus of philosophical analysis to the question of what counts as justification, what are good grounds, and long story about that, right? Next question is, how do we acquire knowledge? Is it through the senses or through pure reason? The empiricists, the rationalists have great disagreement about that. I'm going to be talking tomorrow afternoon about one of the great rationalists, Spinoza, philosopher I feel very strongly about. who believe that basically the way you get justified true belief, the justification is all through pure reason. Which is quite an eccentric point of view. But in any case, the question of how you acquire, what counts as justification and how you acquire this justification, lots and lots of the history of philosophy is taken up with these questions, which still go on. And perhaps the most important epistemological question, because the most kind of emotionally fraught, and I'm always interested in philosophy, even in, when it's philosophy of mathematics, that has some sort of emotional element to it. Are there any absolute limits to knowledge? Are there questions whose answers systematically evade us? We can form the questions, but we can't for the life of us figure out what the answer is. And these are questions that sort of make us know that we're merely human, that we are, it cuts us down to human size. Right? Nope, still don't know. To me, this is like one of the most important things that philosophy has to teach us, are the limits of knowledge. So much of what people claim to know, they not only do they not know, but they can't possibly know. So these epistemological questions are so important because just about every field that we have in which we make claims to knowledge, we are implicitly making epistemological claims. We're claiming to know this, and so we're making claims about knowledge, about that this is possible knowledge. And different fields have implicit in them different epistemological claims. So it's always this kind of, always implicit is the are these implicit philosophical questions. Yes, and as I was saying, that you know, humans have really done so much damage on this planet, so much damage to one another. Excuse me. By thinking that they knew things that they couldn't possibly know. I was actually in New York and very close to the World Trade Center on 9/11. And I watched it happening. Terrible, terrible images that probably will never leave my head. And it became very obvious when the second plane hit that this was a terrorist attack, when it was pretty clear what was happening. And I remember thinking, what the world needs is a good course in epistemology, right? All of these, in some sense, a shallow reflection, but to me not. I mean, it's why I think that philosophy, and especially epistemology, is one of the most important things that we can all study. That, you know, most things that people think that they know, ideologies that they think that they can justify, are often the things that cause the most damage in the world. And so, and in fact, the history of philosophy, especially arises out of this terrible, terrible damage in the history of modern philosophy, and so the whole beginnings of it, again, in the 17th century, arose after the terrible destruction of the religious wars in Europe, and people beginning to think to themselves, people like Bacon and Descartes and John Locke, Leibniz, Spinoza, what is it that we can know? And what are the limits of human knowledge? So this is very historically, and it's very, very important questions. Very well motivated. That the European Enlightenment really arose out of trying to confront the questions of human, the limits of human knowledge. Back to math. So Gödel's incompleteness theorems are so astonishing because they have something to say on these very large, very human questions about human knowledge. They prove mathematically an absolute limitation on what we can prove. And by doing this, they tell us something about the nature of knowledge itself, and perhaps even something about the nature of the knower, of our human minds that know mathematics. Why should we care specifically about mathematical knowledge? Excuse me, what makes it so special? It is special. Mathematical knowledge is extremely special. Extremely unique. It's seen to epistemologists as the best of all possible knowledge because it is so certain that we can have proofs in mathematics. Here's a little. I don't know if this works in your English. You want proof? I'll give you proof. Does this work? Maybe not. Epistemologists have often fantasized, if only all knowledge could be like mathematics. And these are the guys who particularly fantasized about that: Descartes, Spinoza, and Leibniz, right? The great 17th century rationalists who really wanted to make all knowledge be modeled on mathematical knowledge, having proofs and being so certain and so final. And a priori. So this is a term that you know, I'm assuming, a priori, right? Immune to empirical revision. Perhaps necessarily true, the way, after all, how could we know something a priori, that is, not having to resort to empirical methods, unless it were true in all possible worlds, so we don't have to look at this particular one. There are some counterexamples to this, famously written about by a philosopher named Saul Kripke. And that these mathematical truths, if they're a priori, perhaps they're trans-empirical and timeless, they're eternal. In fact, some philosophers have thought that our mathematical knowing minds must be in some sense immortal. Plato, in fact, thought something like this. He has a sort of argument of this sort. Then there's something like this in Spinoza too, and Gödel too was very friendly to this idea that our mathematically knowing minds, you know, being in touch with what's timeless and eternal, there must be something, they must themselves partake somewhat in the eternal. Right, that part of ourselves that can know these truths must partake in the nature of these truths. As I said, very, very big claims have been made on the basis of mathematical knowledge, its very specialness. So proof about the limitations of mathematics is going to be of central interest to epistemologists. So it concerns the best of all possible knowledge. Mathematics, certain, proved, final, conclusive. Okay, so what are the incompleteness theorems? So you're gonna notice that I'm gonna be able to state these mathematical results without using any numbers, any equations. I'm gonna state them in more or less natural English, right? So what the first incompleteness theorem states is that, well, more or less natural English, there are semi-technical terms, for example, formal system. I'll explain that in a moment. Any formal system, which you're all taking logic, in fact, you're going to have an exam on logic, right? So you've been doing first order predicate logic, right? Is that what we've been doing?
We did that last term.
Oh, you did that last term, okay. Maybe you're even going to be doing Gödel's proof of the completeness of predicate logic, maybe? Not sure. Okay. But any formal system of mathematics rich enough to express arithmetic, so not first order predicate logic, but a system in which you can actually express the truths of arithmetic, any such system is either going to be inconsistent, meaning you could derive a contradiction from it, which is a terrible thing for a formal system, horrible, or it's going to be incomplete, meaning that there are certain truths that you won't be able to prove in your formal system. Okay? So this is more or less English, right? Not a symbolic term in here. And that's one of the interesting things. Shows you already that it's an unusual mathematical result. It's stated in normal English. We don't have to explain what one means by a formal system, but you basically know, so we can go through that pretty quickly. But so what it says is any one of these formal systems, and rich enough to express it in arithmetic, is going to have either one of two possible flaws. Either it's inconsistent, which is really lousy, or it's incomplete. Right? So any consistent formal system, rich enough to express arithmetic, is going to be incomplete. To get anything at all out of this statement, you have to say what a formal system is. Think of a formal system as basically, it's a mechanism for proving mathematical theorems. Formal systems are theorem-proving machines. Everything is done mechanically, right? So you've got some rules. They specify your alphabet, the symbols that you're going to be using. They specify how you can put these symbols together in well-formed formulas, and then they specify the rules of derivation. If you have one well-formed formula, what can you get out of that well-formed formula? And it can all be done very mechanically in terms of rules of the sort that you're learning now in logic. Okay, yes, so it's any such formal system where everything is mechanized, everything is rule-governed, is going to have this inadequacy. And why is inconsistency such a terrible thing? I said, yeah, inconsistency is the worst thing that your formal system can suffer. If you can derive a contradiction out of your formal system, if your rules are going to give rise to being able to say that, prove that P is true and also not P is true, your formal system sucks, right? This is a really bad formal system. Why?
There must be something wrong with the rules in the first place.
Yes, but and if you can derive a contradiction from something, you can prove anything, right? Because from a contradiction, everything follows, right? So if you've got P and not P, you can derive absolutely anything. Right? So, yes, totally invalidates the formal system. It's an inconsistent formal system is corrupt because anything follows. Yes, here is my jury of 12 Nazis. And it's as if you have a jury and you're trying a hate crime. You have those here, right? I mean, it's a very bad thing. If you murder somebody in the States, maybe it's the same thing here. If you murder somebody in the States, it's a pretty bad thing. But if you murdered them because they belong to a group that you hate, that's much worse, right? That's a much worse conviction. You're going to get a much more serious penalty for that. Well, let's say you've got a hate crime, right? Somebody's murdered. And these are the guys you have trying it, these 12 Nazis, right? And anything they come up with is going to be pretty invalid. They're not going to regard anything as really a hate crime, are they? And so that's sort of what it's like if you've got an inconsistent system and you're trying to derive things from it, just because you're able to derive it from that system doesn't mean it's true. Just because these guys decide that this is not a hate crime, that this person is innocent, doesn't mean it's not, right? So it's this sort of, it's comparable a little bit, right? okay, so let's get these guys off the screen as fast as possible because they make me sick. So what the first incompleteness system, the first incompleteness theorem says is if your formal system is complete, if it's not thorough, if it's not a Nazi system, then it's going to be incomplete. There are going to be truths that get away from it. You're not going to be able to prove these things. And then what the second incompleteness theorem says, because there are two of them, is that one of the things you can never prove in your formal system is that that formal system is consistent. You can never prove that within. You can actually go out of the system through various techniques and prove that it's consistent, but not within the system. So when you're operating within the system, you can't prove that that system is complete. Why is this such a big deal? It is a big deal, but it was a particularly big deal at the time in which it was introduced. And this is actually when Gödel got a honorary doctorate from Harvard University in the 70s, I think 1975. This was the citation. He was the discoverer of the most significant mathematical truth of the century. Revolutionary for philosophers and logicians. So these are three very important points that are being made here. That it's very, very important mathematical result. Forget the middle one, it's not true. But it's on the border with philosophy. It has something to say about philosophy, that these are mathematically proved results, these two theorems. And what they're saying is about something that can, or actually really more relevantly, can't be done within mathematics. What can and can't be proved within a formal system. So these are mathematical results that have meta-mathematical consequences. The prefix meta comes from the Greek, meaning beyond, above, and what meta-mathematical results involve are these questions about what is it that mathematics is doing. And this is an interesting question. It still is an interesting question because mathematics is so epistemologically special, right? Because it is a priori, because it is conclusive. We're not privy to a lot of knowledge of this sort that is so conclusive, that is a priori. And that raises the question of what is it that we're doing when we're doing mathematics? Are we discovering truths that are really out there, that are somehow encased in mathematical reality, not empirical reality, but a trans-empirical reality, which does sound rather mystical, right? And that's the view of Platonism. Plato certainly believed this to be true. Or are mathematicians inventing their own rules and just kind of carrying out the implications of these rules? Are they making it up as they go along? Is it a kind of game that we play, mathematics? We lay down certain rules and then we see what the implications of these rules are. But there's no special extra Platonic reality that's being described here. And it's because we can do this a priori that this question arises so forcefully. And these are the questions of foundation of mathematics that press in on us, that are we're sort of forced to ask.
And that perhaps Gödel's incompleteness theorems have something to say about. So this is the large epistemological questions. Here, of course, is the first Platonist, right? As depicted by Raphael. And notice this is from the School of Athens. This is just a little part of it. And that's Plato pointing upward and Aristotle, the younger man, pointing downward. And what's Plato pointing upward? Why is Plato pointing upward?
To the forms.
To the forms, but yes, to the forms and to that extra empirical reality that he thinks exists, including mathematics. In fact, in the Republic, in the allegory of the cave, once you get out of the analogy of the line, mathematics is kind of the entryway into the world of the forms. You enter into the abstract through mathematics. Let no one enter herein who has not first studied geometry. It was written right on, supposedly, on the gates to the academy, the first year of the university. So, you know, math certainly is part of, according to Plato, that abstract, extra empirical, trans empirical, eternal world about which knowledge is, right? All knowledge is about that, according to Plato. So perhaps math is about this trans empirical Platonic world, or maybe not. Maybe we're just making it up as we go along, right? It's just a kind of higher form of chess. There are rules, and nobody thinks that there is extra empirical world of chess that's being described by the rules of chess, right? There's no extra world that is reified in the playing of chess. So does math commit us, the fact that we can do math, commit us to this extra trans-empirical reality or not? These are the kinds of questions that we're dealing with here. Especially when it has to do with infinity. Why do I have Groucho Marx here? I'm hoping some of you can tell me because I've forgotten. Well, Groucho Marx had this question, he had a comment, you know, that he wouldn't want to belong to any private club that would have him, right? And so the question is, how did we get into this club of having a priori certain knowledge? How did the likes of us get into this club? Who are we to have a priori knowledge? And these are the sorts of questions that we're concerned with here. Always I'm trying to compare it to other questions to motivate this. So, for example, we all know that slavery is wrong, right? None of us can look at this picture without cringing, right? But we discovered slavery is wrong. Actually, you people discovered it, and you English people discovered it before we did in the States, right? 1787 was first proposed in Parliament to outlaw slavery, and I think it was finally outlawed in the colonies in 1830. The States were no longer, as you know, by 1830, we were no longer colonies of the British, and therefore we had to fight a civil war in order to discover, or in order for slavery to be abolished. We can ask this question about slavery. Here it is, it was finally abolished in the 13th Amendment. Is slavery's wrongness a truth that we eventually discovered? It took us a long time. One wonders why it took us so long, but is it something that we actually discovered? Or is it just something that we've agreed is wrong in the US, at least because one side fought this and won the Civil War? Another way of asking this question is, did Congress outlaw slavery because it's wrong? Or is it wrong because Congress outlawed it? So too, we can ask about mathematical truth, right? Are mathematicians able to prove
their theorems because those theorems are true, or are they true because mathematicians prove them? That's the question, right, that we're trying to answer here. We can distinguish two basic schools here. The Platonists, who say that, look, we're able to prove these theorems true because they're true. They describe mathematical reality. This is a kind of mathematical realism. There is, in fact, a trans-empirical reality. And on the other side are those that say that mathematical theorems are true because we prove them. This is a mathematical anti-empiricalism, realism. This is Gertrude Stein, do you recognize her? Gertrude, the great writer. And that's Oakland, California at the time that Gertrude Stein was writing. And Gertrude Stein said, there's no there about her, about Oakland, California. She was an expatriate. She lived in power. So these Gödel's incompleteness theorems are able to reach outside of themselves in a way, something like an Escher picture, right? That they're able to talk about what mathematics does. And this was actually for the new year, for 2000, Time magazine had an issue talking about the 100 most important thinkers of the last century. Einstein actually was number one. Gödel was number 75, but at least he made the list. And this description of him was that he turned the lens of mathematics on itself, right? So in just this way that I'm trying to describe to you, right, to try to use mathematics and mathematical proof to say what mathematics is about, and hit upon his famous incompleteness theorems, driving a stake through the heart of formalism, right? So he ended one particular meta-mathematical view, formalism. And what formalism was this view, this anti-realist view of mathematics, a particular kind of anti-realist view of mathematics that basically said that mathematics is a higher form of chess, that it's all rule-governed, it's the kind of thing that a mindless machine could do, it's all run by rules, by algorithms, and particularly kind of rule, we'll get to that in a moment. Why would, and I have to say that at the time that Gödel discovered his incompleteness theorems, formalism was the reigning view in the foundations of mathematics, in philosophy of mathematics. It was the view in meta mathematics. Why? Well, in general, I mean, Platonism sounds rather mystical, and this trans-empirical reality and all that, and how, in fact, do our little minds, our finite minds, come in contact with this trans-empirical reality? There's always been that problem. But there were even more particular problems that motivated most mathematicians of the day to be formalists. And what these were paradoxes. And I know that you know about paradoxes, right? Because you're going to have a test on paradoxes, right? Paradoxes are, there were some paradoxes that maybe you even know about that were discovered in set theory, which is a very important foundational branch of mathematics. Paradoxes are extremely bad. It's an extremely bad situation. It's a crisis. It's an emergency when you discover paradoxes cropping up in one of your branches of mathematics. Because what a formal paradox is that, as you know, that you're able to prove that something, some P, is both true and not true. And the way a formal paradox works is you show that if P is true, then you can actually derive that it's false. Therefore, it must be false. If assuming P is true gives you that P is false, it must be true that P is false. But then you're also able to show that if P is false, then it's also true. So that means P must be true. So what you've got is P is both true and P is false. And this is bad, right? Because this is a contradiction. This is what we don't want, right? And what we were able to show, and you know about this one, the sentence is false, right? We've been through this. This is old, the ancient liar's paradox, right? So this sentence is false. Is the sentence true or is it false? What does it even mean, right? This sort of thing. Most people, when you try to explain this to them, they want to get away from you as fast as possible, unless they're a mathematician or a philosopher, then they're going to be very, very interested. Right, so this sentence is false. Is it true? Well, if it's true, it's false, because that's what it says, right? That's the content of the sentence. So if it's true, it's false. It must be false. If it's false, it's true, right? And so this sentence is false. This proposition must be both true and false. It's that's a paradox, right? And very briefly, here's a little cartoon. Hey, Gabe, you know the liar paradox? You mean the problem of assigning a truth value to the statement, this sentence is not true. Sure, that's a really ancient and famous paradox. Yeah, it's been driving me nuts, but I think I finally figured out how to solve it. The answer is the statement is neither true nor false. Nice try, Nestor, but that doesn't really help at all. If the sentence is neither true nor false, then it's not true, but that just confirms what the sentence says, which means it's true, which means that it's not true, etc. You still end up with the same paradoxical result. Oh, I guess you're right. Dang it, Gabe. This paradox is going to drive me crazy. Perhaps I can help. Have you? I mean, I can relate so strongly to this. it's Mr. McDragon, the greatest dragon philosopher in the world. Can you solve the liar paradox? No, but I can stop it from driving you crazy. How? So, I mean, these are dreadful things. The mind crashes, right, at these paradoxes. And here's Bertrand Russell, gotten up as Sherlock Holmes, discoverer of a very famous paradox, right? Russell's paradox. Have you heard of Russell's paradox? You have. Okay, so the set of all sets that aren't members of themselves. Just quickly, because some of you are saying you've heard of it, some of you haven't, Russell's paradox. So, you know, you have a set, right? It's a bunch of stuff, right? So some sets can be members of themselves. Most sets are not members of themselves. So the set of all people in this, well, actually, I have a picture. I made this picture specially for you, right? Here's the set of royals, right? This is the set of royals. Is this set a member of itself? How many say it is?
It's a definition of the set.
The set is this set, this group of. Is this set a member of itself? No, because the set is a set. It's an abstract entity. It's not a royal. It's a mathematical entity. It's a the set of is an abstract entity. So this set is not a member of itself. Most sets are not members of themselves. But the set of let's say the set of all sets if it could exist. Actually, that's a paradox. The set of all sets can't exist. But if it could exist, it would be a member of itself because it contained all sets. It would contain itself. Okay, so the set of all sets that aren't members of themselves, is it a member of itself? So it is the set that contains all and only all sets that aren't members of themselves. Is it a member of itself? Think about it. If it is, then it isn't, since it contains only sets that aren't members of themselves. And if it isn't, then it is, because it contains all the sets that aren't members of itself. So it both is and isn't a member of itself. This is Russell's paradox, right? It was a very big deal. If you read Russell's autobiography, which I really recommend, he discovered it when he was quite young, and it really ruined his summer vacation, right? It was really, but even worse than that, it ruined Greg's Great work. So the Frege is just about to publish the foundations of arithmetic. And the fact that we could form this paradox using what we now call naive set theory, naive because it allows us to form these paradoxes, was a very big deal. It showed that something was amiss in one's system. And the greatest mathematician of his day, who was David Hilbert, great German mathematician, said, admittedly, the present state of affairs where we run up against the paradoxes is intolerable. Just think, the definitions and deductive methods which everyone learns, teaches, and uses in mathematics lead to absurdities. What absurdities? These paradoxes, like Russell's paradox, right? If mathematical thinking is defective, where are we to find truth and certitude? That's a poignant statement, right? Anybody who thinks there's no poignancy in mathematics, read that statement. I mean, really, where are we to find truth and certainty if not in mathematics? And the math that was being used led to paradox. Formalize, right? We have to turn mathematics into a rule-governed, mindless activity that can that machines could perform, and not rely on our intuitions, because our intuitions are untrustworthy. We were relying on our intuitions for these systems that led to paradox. And so that's why formalism, particularly at that moment in time, had risen as a kind of mathematical program. In fact, Hilbert had a program which was to formalize all mathematics, to show that all mathematics could be reduced to these formal systems, and so to get rid of our intuitions in mathematics. And now you see why Gödel, you know, at that particular moment was so important, drove a stake through the heart of formalism. He showed that the reigning view, the view that was supposed to help us get rid of all paradox, to make mathematics safe again, wouldn't work. That we have to rely on our intuitions in mathematics, faulty as they may be. Okay, I want to give you a little sense of how he did this. This is going to be really fast. One of the things that's so amazing about the proof is that it's got a kind of double speak to it. It's a kind of dictionary, picture of a dictionary here, and this is where the real work of the proof goes. Every arithmetical statement is translated into a mathematical statement. So you have perfectly arithmetical statements, 2 + 2 = 4, I mean all sorts of, that are also saying something about the formal system itself. And it's a little bit, I describe it to my students a little bit like, if you have a friend who's a narcissist, surely we have no narcissists in this room, but you know in your experience people who are narcissists, and everything that they say has a double meaning. So everything that they say relates also, they're saying something meta about themselves. It's self-referential. They're saying something about themselves. So, you know, I went to this party last night and it was just so amazingly great. Translates into, I am so much cooler than you, right? I went to this party and you weren't there. And everything, and once you get the kind of dictionary of these people, they'll amuse you very much or they'll drive you crazy, because everything that they say translates into a statement also about themselves, right? That's what Gödel does with arithmetic in this system. It's just amazing. So that everything that's just a stream of numbers, an equation of numbers, is also saying something about the status of that proposition in the formal system, right? So it has this kind of doublespeak. And in particular, he takes one proposition, and here's to a lot of work in the dictionary to get to this proposition, but what this arithmetical proposition translates into is saying something about itself and its status in the system, and what it's saying is, I'm not provable in this formal system. It's able to do this. And then and he's able to do this when every time I read the proof, it's like, I can't believe that he actually did this, right? He had to do so much nitty-gritty detailed work in order to get to this. But there is an arithmetical proposition, and what it's also saying is, I'm not provable in the formal system. Every proposition can be negated, right, if it's a well-formed formula. So including this one. I'm naming it N. So we're going to call, we actually usually call it this proposition that's talking about itself in its way, G for Gödel, but I'm calling it N for narcissist, because that's how I remember. and so this proposition, which is also just saying something numerical, but it's also saying I'm not provable in the system, can be negated. And what it's saying is, if it's negated, is N is not, so N says N is not provable in this formal system. So non-N says N is provable in this formal system, right? So now we ask, you knew I was going to ask this question, right? This is always the move with these self-referential questions. Is N provable in the formal system? So is this proposition, which means something arithmetical, but it's also saying I'm not provable in this formal system, is it provable in the formal system? What's your intuition? What do you think? It either is or it isn't. Let's say it is provable in the formal system. The negation of N is provable in this formal system, because N is not provable in the formal system, so the negation is that it is provable in the formal system. So if N is provable in the system, its negation is true, right? But if the negation of a proposition is true, that means the proposition itself is false. So if N is provable in this formal system, then N is false. But if N is provable in this formal system, then N is also true. We only prove true propositions in a formal system. So if we're able to prove that it's provable, it must be true. So if N is provable in the system, then N has got to be true, and N has got to be false, which is a flat-out contradiction. And we're assuming this system to be consistent. What does that mean? That means that if this formal system is consistent, N is not provable in the formal system, right? Does anybody follow this? Okay. So we've just concluded N is not provable in the formal system if the system is consistent. But that's exactly what N says. Right? N says, I'm not provable in the formal system. So we know that N is true. We know that N is true because it's not provable in the formal system, right? It can't possibly be provable in the formal system if the formal system is consistent. So it's true. So we know, but that's exactly what Gödel's first incompleteness theorem says. Do you see? It's beautiful. It's amazing. It's wondrous. Therefore, assuming the consistency of the system N is both unprovable and true, we've done it. We've got it, right? We've got a proposition which we know is not provable if the system is consistent, which we're assuming to be true. Because other who's interested in inconsistent systems? They're worthless. They're Nazis, right? Then if it's a consistent system, we know that it's not provable, but we also know that it's true. Oh, that's a second. Never mind that. Okay, so we've got it. And remember that because of this wondrous dictionary that Gödel has produced, this N has a straightforward arithmetical meaning. So we've got
proposition of arithmetic that is true but not provable in the formal system. And it's true, and it escapes the formal system. So formalism, can't get at it, right? That's how we drove a stake through the heart of formalism. It's wondrous. Okay, so the second incompleteness theorem is that we can't prove the consistency of the formal system in the system itself. And that's basically a straightforward consequence of the first incompleteness theorem. If we could prove the consistency, you see, because we're assuming the consistency of the formal system, if we could actually prove, and from that consistency, the truth of N follows, right? From the first incompleteness theorem, we just went through that. So if we actually could formally prove the consistency of the system, that would amount to a proof of N, which can't be, right? We can't prove N in the formal system. Therefore, if we could prove, all right, you see it, right? It's sort of, I'm just going over and over today. So we can't prove the consistency of N in the formal system. Voila, that's Gödel's second incompleteness theorem, right? And actually, von Neumann, after he went home, I think the conference was in Germany. And von Neumann, who was also at the Institute for Advanced Study, in fact, he was partly responsible for bringing Gödel there. So he went back to Princeton. He was also on the run from the Nazis. He was a Hungarian Jew. And he went back and he thought about what Gödel had indicated from his first incompleteness theorem. And he said to Gödel, he wrote to Gödel, said, hey, wait a minute. This follows. You can't prove the consistency of a formal system within the system. He saw, very smart guy, von Neumann. You can't prove the consistency of the formal system within the system. He saw that straightforward consequence of the first incompleteness theorem. And Gödel wrote back and said, yeah, well, of course, right. I mean, I have a formal proof for that too. So, and that was really interesting because this really showed that Hilbert's formalism couldn't work. Okay, so what follows from this? Something follows from this, right? Certainly the formalism that everybody had signed on to pre-Gödel doesn't seem possible post-Gödel. But there are various ways, conclusions one could draw. So yes, it's a priori, and yes, it's even a priori about infinite domains. It's always infinity where problems crop up. But there's nothing mysterious here, and that was the view. Now something has got to go here, post Gödel, right? We can't hold to this particular kind of formalism. So Gödel showed that this statement of formalism had to be revised, okay? But there's a whole range of choices, right? The mathematical revisionist response, our mathematical knowledge, it is mechanical, though it doesn't range over those infinite domains that mathematicians lay claim to. I have a very good friend who's a mathematician who holds by this. And he just believes that he's a constructivist. He doesn't allow this kind of infinite domains. There's a great deal of mathematics that he says is illicit. If you can't reduce it to this purely mechanical stuff, then Gödel shows you're not allowed to have this mathematics. But this is a horrible thing because a great deal of beautiful mathematics goes out the window. It's really, I don't like this view at all. That we're machines, but we're overreaching ourselves, right? And that's why we get into these paradoxes and other logical mishaps, where I guess the way I like to put it, and my friend who holds to this view likes my way of putting it, we're machines with delusions of grandeur, right? We think we have all this mathematical knowledge that we don't really have.
formalism was right about there being no there, right, Gertrude Stein's statement, and our mathematical knowledge is nothing more than the consequences of the rules we decided upon. Okay, so that's one way that you might go. There's the postmodernist response, the POMO response. Our mathematical knowledge isn't special. After all, it isn't certain, none of it is. It partakes of the same uncertainty and shiftingness as all of human life. And this is a very favorite response of people in the humanities, right? That's why Gödel's Incompleteness Theorem is often the sort of the one thing that people in the humanities like very much, and it shows, you mathematicians, you think everything is so, there's something special and a priori and final, and no, it's the same as all of our knowledge. There's nothing certain there. And so again, formalism was right about there being no there, but it was wrong about math being in any way special. There's that possible response, right? There's the plainness response, right? That was Gödel. Gödel actually thought he was proving Platonism. This is very poignant. He fell in love with Platonism when he was about your age, when he was an undergraduate in the University of Vienna. And it was actually in a philosophy class taught by somebody named Theodor Gomperz, G-O-M-P-E-R-Z, that he first became exposed to Platonism, and he just felt it was really the passion of his life, right? This notion that we can have knowledge and certain knowledge of this higher domain, of this trans-empirical plane. And he switched his major to mathematics at that point. He conceived this outsized ambition that he was going to prove mathematically Platonism, right? So that was his response to this, right? That in fact, the incompleteness theorems, far from showing that there's no there, show that there's too much there for our measly little formal systems to contain. Notice that we were able to show that there is a true proposition which we can't prove in the formal system, but we know that it's true, right? The argument that I gave you showed that it was true. So we know that it's true. So our mathematical knowledge exceeds our formal proofs. And actually a lot of mathematicians believe this, right? That our intuitions, give us access to this realm, this Platonic realm, and we can formalize it. Formal systems are sort of an afterthought. Then you prove it in your formal systems. But really we're accessing these truths in this trans-empirical realm. This is basically, so formalism was right about our a priori knowledge that ranges over infinite matters, but it was wrong about there being no there. And this was the conclusion that Gödel himself proved, and then I think there's in fact very good evidence that this was the philosophical conclusion he was after the whole time, that this is what was guiding his proof. And then there's the anti-mechanist response. Roger Penrose, is this a name you know? Yes? So Roger Penrose, who's a polymath, really, he's a physicist, a mathematician, and a philosopher. And he published some very interesting popular books. One is called The Emperor's in the Mind. The other is called Shadows of the Mind, in which he actually tries to use Gödel's incompleteness. He's a Platonist. He's a very strong Platonist, Roger Penrose. He takes Gödel's interpretation of Gödel's incompleteness theorems very, very seriously, and he goes even further and says that the incompleteness theorems not only show that mathematical truth is independent of provability, our knowledge is the truth, is independent of provability, our knowledge is independent of provability, but the mathematics, yeah. And after all, we know that N is true, even though we can't prove that it's true. Our minds, what this shows, these claims, is that our minds, in knowing mathematics, are proving themselves not to be something that could be duplicated by a formal system. So we are not You're not mere rule-following machines, not even in mathematics, much less in other things. But if even in mathematics, we're not mere rule-governed machines. We are not computers. We are not digital computers. So, and that is in fact the question that I wanted to ask Kurt Gödel when I told you, never be so shy that you don't ask people questions. The question I wanted to ask him was, there had been a philosopher who had, in 1967, so many, many years before Roger Penrose, had put forth an argument like Penrose's argument, saying, can't we derive from Kurt Gödel, from Gödel's incompleteness theorems, that our minds are not machines, that what we know in mathematics can't be reduced to what machines can do. And I wanted to ask Kurt Gödel at that one little party that I was at, what did he think of that argument? And I was afraid to ask him. Really regret that. So anyway, very quickly to recap, real quickly, mathematics has always seemed at once so promising and so problematic to epistemologists because of its certainty. How can the likes of us attain such certainty and about matters so far from our own limited experience, extending out so that we can explore even infinite, finite little us? One answer given was formalism. Mathematical knowledge can be contained in formal systems, specifically by the rules for manipulating symbols, and because these rules are, recursive. Oh, I didn't use that word. These rules are recursive, which means that you apply a rule, and then you apply the rule to the result of applying the rule, and you just keep doing that. That's what recursion is, right? So it's a rule. You just keep applying it and applying it and applying it to the results that you get, and that's recursion. And that's what formal systems use, basically. It's recursion that allows us to get to infinity. You just keep applying the rules to the results of the rules, and you can generate infinite results. Formalism, by removing intuitions from mathematical knowledge, would allow us to remove the mystery and would be able to make sure, eliminate our paradoxes from mathematics. It required us to formalize mathematics. A young man named Kurt Gödel, flying in the face of all the accepted wisdom of his day, proved that any consistent formal system of mathematics rich enough to express arithmetic would be incomplete. We can always do this. We can add on our axioms. We'll always be able to generate n. There's always a way of generating n. You can keep trying to add on axioms, trying to make it complete. You can always do what Gödel showed us we can do. He also showed us we can't prove it. Consistency. He was able to do this by this double talk method. Just as he produced arithmetical propositions that were simultaneously talking about themselves, so he produced these conclusions. And in some sense, I think that we can't even figure out, and we can't even decide on what these incompleteness theorems really mean. Philosophers are still arguing about them. Gödel thinks he proved Platonism. Philosophers disagree. Philosophers of mathematics disagree. All of which I think just shows how incomplete we are. We can't even decide what the results really mean, what Gödel's incompleteness theorems really mean. But anyway, they're magnificent, and they mean something. They mean something. And in the end, perhaps it's your own intuitions that'll guide you to try to interpret what these theorems really mean. What is the mathematical view that, what is it saying about us who know mathematics?